A dramatic capture. The world's most wanted, most dangerous drug lord, Joaquín El Chapo Guzmán, back in Mexican custody tonight.
Lots of evidence shows really consistently when you take out kingpins, you generate more violence. Where there's a demand, there's going to be a supply.
Mexico's most notorious drug kingpin, Joaquín El Chapo Guzmán, has been awaiting trial in the U.S. since his dramatic capture in 2016. Federal prosecutors have filed multiple counts of drug trafficking, murder, money laundering, and kidnapping charges against Guzmán, who ran the notorious Sinaloa cartel for more than 40 years. El Chapo gained notoriety for his daring prison escapes and his controversial interview with Hollywood star Sean Penn while hiding as a fugitive from the law. While the U.S. and Mexican governments have declared El Chapo's capture a major win in the drug war, Harvard economist Jeffrey Miron thinks his story better illustrates the folly of prohibition.
It's incredibly unlikely that the arrest of El Chapo or any kingpin means anything significant, except possibly in the very short term, there might be some minor disruption, because there are lots of lieutenants who would love to step into the role that El Chapo was serving. There are relatives, like his brother, who might step into that role. He might continue to run the empire from prison, as he's done several times in the past. So no, it's very, very remote that there would be any meaningful impact.
I think of kingpins as being very rare, and we've seen over the last few decades this focus on capturing. It's called the kingpin strategy. You know, we have to cut the head off the snake. But what have been some of the unintended consequences of this supply side focus on enforcement?
The most obvious unintended consequence is to increase the amount of violence in the countries where we go after kingpins. And the reason is fairly intuitive. If there's one person who's been head of some big empire and that person's removed, then there are probably 3, 4, 10 different lieutenants below who all would like to be the new kingpin, but there's no easy mechanism in an underground organization to choose which one is the right one. There's no corporate board who will do it all by looking at CVs and so on. So there's likely to be wars between those different lieutenants, or some rival drug organization might think it can take over an organization that has just had its head cut off. So lots of evidence shows really consistently when you take out kingpins, you generate more violence.
What are the numbers that you have to back that up?
The numbers come from looking at, I think the best study is actually not the one we did at Cato, it was done by a colleague of mine at Harvard, where she identified elections in Mexico when the PAN won that had mayoral elections that had outcomes that were very, very close. So she compared cities where the PAN candidate, the PAN was the one who wanted to take out the kingpins, just barely won, compared to cities where the PAN candidate just barely lost. So the PAN strategy of going after kingpins was implemented in some cities, but not others, for reasons that were basically random. And you saw substantial increases in violence in those cities, and you saw spillovers into neighboring cities that were on the trafficking routes or related activity to the cities where these escalations of going after kingpins had occurred.
Just looking at the business side of it, because you've written before in your research that, you know, actually capturing these drug suppliers makes cartels more competitive. And if we look at El Chapo, you know, he was more seen in Mexico kind of as a businessman. He's kind of this legend. What does his arrest illustrate as far as the business side is concerned? Is the cartel going to adapt to the changing market forces?
Certainly cartels that have lost their leaders have adapted throughout history. But one possibility that happens sometimes, that you hinted at just a second ago, is if the organization breaks up from having one large cartel that's a very large fraction of the market into 2 or 3 or 4 sub-organizations that now compete with each other, now you have more market pressure to lower prices because you have a lot of firms instead of only 1 or 2 firms. And there's evidence to suggest that when we interfere with, on the supply side, with the drug trade, by taking out kingpins in other ways, we tend to lower prices partially because we're making the market more competitive.
So basically,
so
the exact
it's exactly
opposite.
Counterproductive. It's exactly the opposite of what we're trying to do.
We see the evidence that this is not working the way that we want it to, but you have a lot of drug warriors that put forth the argument that, you know, people like El Chapo and other kingpins, they would be criminals without the drug trade. So taking them off the street, putting them in jail is the right thing to do. There's this moral argument that this is the right thing to do. What do you say to that?
I'll certainly take it as a given that El Chapo, other kingpins, have committed significant numbers of violent, heinous acts. So should those particular people be in jail? Arguably, yes. Okay, there should be a trial, there should be evidence, there should be all the due process, and all, but plausibly that's the case. But that's completely different than the policy question of whether we should outlaw drugs. By outlawing drugs, we make some people into criminals who wouldn't otherwise be criminals. They get attracted by the high levels of money that they can make in the illegal trade. And without that, without the prohibition, they would stay in the legal sector. Then maybe there are some people who are going to be unpleasant criminals no matter what the policy is, even under legalization. But by outlawing drugs, we make them much richer than they would be and allow them to be much more powerful. So it's still a lose-lose, even if you grant that assumption from the prohibitionist.
And I feel like we saw this too with the prohibition of alcohol.
It's exactly the same thing. The vast majority of the alcohol trade went legit after alcohol was re-legalized in the United States at the end of Prohibition in 1933, and far fewer people were committing either petty crimes by consuming a little alcohol or more serious crimes by trafficking it. Instead of encouraging people to disobey the law, to learn to disrespect the law and ignore it, okay, we can let it be legal and only punish those people who actually behave badly by driving under the influence or doing something which harms innocent third parties.
El Chapo told Rolling Stone in that famous video interview, he said the day that he stops existing, nothing's going to happen to the drug trade. It's still going to go on. Now we see Trump's come out with these new policies. He wants to increase mandatory minimums, even institute the federal death penalty for drug dealers. How are Trump's proposals ignoring the economic reality of these cartels?
The most fundamental economic reality, exactly what El Chapo referred to, is where there's a demand, there's going to be a supply. If people want to consume marijuana or heroin or cocaine or whatever it is, the market will find a way to supply it, and policy can do very little to prevent that. Policy can perhaps raise the cost of supplying it. So one way to do that is to just impose a standard sin tax the way we do for alcohol and tobacco. And libertarians are not necessarily enthusiastic about sin taxes, but they would agree they do relatively modest damage. Okay, as long as they're kept moderate, because the market stays above ground, most people can buy from a standard supplier. It's a legal product, so you can sue if you get a bad dose. People can advertise. It's readily available. You don't have to go to dangerous neighborhoods to purchase it. Everything works just fine. The policy of outlawing it, okay, just says that you're going to make it create all sorts of extra evil by driving the market underground, and maybe you raise some of the costs of supplying it. So maybe you raise the price to consumers and reduce the quantity consumed a little bit. But the evidence suggests only a very little bit, in part perhaps because law enforcement is really not very effective, not very competent at trying to raise those costs, so it only does so to a minor degree.
It's a lot of resources to put into that for just a very minor change in consumption.
And you're trying, I mean, think about trying to outlaw, to take the most extreme case, marijuana. Marijuana grows in every state in the union. People can grow it in their attics, in their bathtubs, in their basements. It grows in national parks. I mean, so imagine trying to shut down that activity. You would need millions and millions and millions of police whose only job was to try to go after the marijuana trade. It's just impossible to think that you're raising the price more than a very, very small amount. For more thinly purchased products like, say, heroin, maybe you can have a somewhat bigger effect. But even there are just too many consumers and suppliers for enforcement to work very well.
Although Trump has said he would support legislation to protect states that have legalized marijuana, he may be opening a new front in the drug war to combat what he calls the terrible crisis of opioid and drug addiction.
As to whether we're restarting the drug wars, that certainly seems to be a risk. The things that Jeff Sessions says and that President Trump says are very scary along that dimension, because we had made a lot of progress in scaling back the war on drugs, especially with respect to marijuana, but more broadly as well, just because enforcement had in some ways moderated. But I'm not sure we're going to restart, because public opinion has still stayed relatively sympathetic. It still has not come around to re-endorsing a virulent drug war. So I think the jury's sort of out on that. As evidence of what happens when you really do scale back prohibition, the most illustrative example is probably Portugal, which decriminalized, technically decriminalized, but de facto basically legalized not just marijuana, but essentially all drugs. They've seen no meaningful change in use from youth or adults. They've seen decreases in HIV infection rates, decreases in relevant categories of crime, decreases in drug overdoses. It's just an unambiguous success And so that's one obvious example of what happens. You can, of course, can also look to the United States. Before 1914, when we created these laws, the number of negative effects associated with drugs wasn't zero. Of course, some people misused them, some people OD'd, okay? But the number was very, very small, and there was no violence associated with the trade, there was no corruption, there were no infringements on civil liberties from the effort to try to enforce the law, and so on. Another country that's often pointed to as an example is the Netherlands, and especially Amsterdam, where marijuana in particular is very, very technically still illegal, but widely available, and the law is deliberately and explicitly not enforced. So almost anybody wants it can get it very readily.
I feel like some people are okay with marijuana being legal, but when you start talking about other drugs like cocaine or heroin, it's like, well, those are very hard drugs. We don't want to do that. Right. I mean, is the picking and choosing of that, is that better policy than just what we have now, or full-scale prohibition? I mean, is that realistic?
My view, the best policy is to legalize everything. And the reason is that the harms come almost entirely from the prohibitions, not from the properties of the substance. Remember that in the 50s and 40s, people thought that marijuana turned you into a homicidal killer. Okay? There were all sorts of allegations about the negative effects of marijuana. There were huge concerns in the 80s about crack cocaine, claiming that it was creating a generation of crack babies, which turned out to almost all be a complete myth. So are opioids potentially more dangerous than marijuana? Yes. It's certainly possible to take an overdose of opioids, whereas for marijuana, it's almost impossible to document that anyone has ever taken an overdose of marijuana. At the same time, there are tens of things that are widely available that people don't OD on unless they explicitly are attempting to commit suicide that are in everybody's medicine cabinet, like ibuprofen. So, and alcohol is in most people's houses and so on. So if it were available in a legal market, heroin would be only slightly more dangerous, okay, than marijuana, because it would be marketed and packaged in a way that told people the dosage, then the purity. It would be clear that the appropriate dose was some very, very small amount. And the vast majority of people who don't want to die, okay, but simply want pain relief or whatever relief they get from opioids, would consume an appropriate dose, just as they do with all their medications. I mean, most people don't take 50 Advil because they have a headache. They
know that they should only take 2 Advil. Because we have the education and the information to know not to do that.
It's public, you talk about, your parents told you how many to take when you were 10, and so it's not a big deal. And my claim is that we would have exactly the same situation with any drug, okay, if it were fully available in a legal market.
Looking at the whole scope of this, what can we learn from El Chapo as far as the drug war is concerned?
I'm afraid it's not necessarily that we haven't learned the economics. It's that the incentives for too many participants in the whole debate and the policy making have incentives that go against doing the economically sensible policy. People in the treatment sector are getting a lot more revenue because tons of people are forced into treatment by the criminal justice system, by the prohibition. So that's one huge interest group that favors continued prohibition. The criminal justice system has a lot more demand for police and for prosecutors, judges, et cetera, okay, because we're conducting prohibition. There are other groups, like the alcohol industry or tobacco industry, that are not so excited about legalizing products which might end up being substitutes for the products that they sell. And then there, of course, is, I think, lots of confusion. People who think that it's drugs that generate violence, whereas in my view, standard economics view, it's the drug prohibition which causes violence, the drug prohibition which causes the corruption. So until we can persuade more people that they're not thinking about it quite right, there's going to be lots of people who are just nervous about big increases in use and or increases in violence. And until we need to get the message out better and more.